Yeah, welcome to the Hellraisers Ball, where decadence and depravity are the laws of the land. So strap yourself in, kids. It's going to be a wild ride. Tonight, I'm with Dr. Dan over at Adventureland Studios, where we filmed the John Oliva interview just a few short weeks ago.
Absolutely.
And we're going to be rebroadcasting that video later on this evening.
Cool.
I also have a brand new interview that was just done this past weekend over at Seminole Music.
Wonderful.
Here in Seminole, Florida. Special thanks to John Spinelli, manager at Seminole Music, for making that all happen. Where I interviewed legendary drummer Shawn Drover from a legendary metal band, Megadeth. And we're going to be doing that broadcast in just a few short minutes.
Cool.
We're also going to be doing a feature interview here with Dr. Dan. He's going to tell us about his music career and some of his influences.
Yeah.
We'll probably touch on a whole bunch of other stuff.
Absolutely.
And so, Dr. Dan, real briefly, introduce yourself to people. Some people may know you because of your collaboration with Jon Oliva on this new solo album, Raise the Curtain.
Yeah.
Some people may know you because of your affiliation with Jon prior to the solo album.
Yes.
But
yes.
I'm sure there are some people that are watching from home that don't know who you are, so tell us a little bit about you.
Well, you know, to sum it all up, you know, I met Jon Oliva like 15 years ago, and we happened to hit it off with him musically and emotionally, and we, over the years, started writing together, and one thing led to another, and here we are in 2013. Releasing an album together and have future plans to release several more.
Awesome. Now, I've actually got to see your band, one of your bands play Doctrine.
Yes.
And Doctrine opened for Jon Oliva, Jon Oliva's band.
Yes.
Over at the Ritz.
Yes.
In Ybor City when they did the 25th anniversary of Paul the Mannequin.
Yeah, well, that was actually back in 2008. And it was actually,
I'm talking about the one from just about a year ago, over here.
No, I didn't open for him then. I didn't
know. Doctrine wasn't on the film.
No.
Oh, so you played with him back in 2008.
In 2008, okay. Yes. Yes, we opened for him at Bourbon Street. That was our first serious, I guess you can call it, gig together. And from that time on, we just hit it off and started writing together. Especially after Matt LaPorte passing away on us, which was a dear friend to both of us.
And that was a tragedy.
And that was a tragedy, and that's what led to Raise the Curtain.
Wow. Yeah. And so, had it not been for that happening, Raise the Curtain may have never happened, and this whole collaboration might not have happened.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yes. Yes. Matter of fact, as John is aware of, the evening of me coming home after attending Matt's viewing, I happened to write a song for Matt, and that song will more than likely be released on the next solo album.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
That's fantastic. And so now, we spoke to John a few weeks back, and, you know, we talked about the Raise the Curtain album, and we also, you know, kind of give people a little bit of insight behind the record.
Yes.
And also a little bit of insight as to what's coming up this Saturday over at the State Theater in St. Petersburg, Florida.
Yes.
It's going to be a very special show.
Yes.
And kind of a behind the curtain, if you will.
Well, I'm sure that show will be very special. All the shows, I'm sure, have been great. And I've gotten a lot of feedback and press releases listening to it on YouTube. But Saturday night will be a very, very special event. It will be not only myself playing some of the songs from Raise the Curtain, but we're also going to entertain having, which is very precious, Jim and Tom Morris from Morris Sound Studios in Tampa. We're also going to have Dr. Lorien, who played several riffs on the Raise the Curtain album, and several other guests. So Saturday night will be a special event compared to the last 9 storyteller shows. And we intentionally wanted it to be
that. Dallas now, right?
Yes, they're in Dallas tonight as we're speaking, yes.
So now when we spoke to John here just a few weeks ago, just before Thanksgiving, and they actually headed out the Friday after.
Yes.
And they've been on the road now for about a week and a half.
Correct, yes, yes.
And from what I've heard so far, from my little reports I get here and there from Dana Piper, things have been going well. I know there's been a few mishaps and stuff that have happened on the road. Yeah. But all in all, I heard the shows are going very well.
Shows have been going very, very well. The attendance has been fantastic. And the feedback that I've gotten from it is great. And I'm really glad the fans are happy with everything that's happening.
Yeah, and I think a lot of people are going to be thrilled on Saturday when they see this show. Because, you know, like John touched on, like what you're telling us right here, is it is going to be a special show. I think it's going to be like a one-of-a-kind type moment that people just aren't going to want to miss. And we're going to re-air the broadcast of the John Oliva interview in just a little bit. But right now, we're actually going to air an interview that I just did this past Sunday with Shawn Drover from Megadeth. And after that, we'll come back a little bit.
Right.
We'll talk more about you.
Sounds great.
And then we'll show the John Oliva interview.
Wonderful.
So let's see what we got here. Hellraisers Ball rocking it out right here at Seminole Music in Seminole, Florida. And we're here talking with Shawn Drover, drummer for legendary thrash metal band Megadeth.
How you doing?
I'm doing great. How you doing today?
Good. Where are you from? You got a New York accent. What are you doing down here?
I'm from the Bronx.
You're from the Bronx?
Yeah.
How'd you end up down here?
Oh, man, I just wanted to change of pace.
Got tired of freezing to death in winter?
Yeah, got tired of the snow. You know,
now you boil to death down here.
Now I boil to death in Florida. So now you're originally from Canada, correct?
Yes, I am. I know all about freezing to death. Yes,
you
I do.
You do?
Yeah.
So
originally born and raised in Montreal.
That's a hell of a lot more frigid than the Bronx.
Honestly, I moved down here as well. I lived in Montreal until I was 18, moved to Toronto, and literally remember going to work one day on the bus and just saying, you know what, I can't take this cold anymore. So I actually moved down here to St. Petersburg, Florida.
Oh, get out.
Yep.
So
back, back in 87, I lived down here for about 3 years.
Oh, wow. So you still have a lot of ties here?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, this is, you know, I lived here for 3 years. It's kind of homecoming to me,
Cool.
So, yeah.
So now, currently, you're living in where, Atlanta, Georgia?
I live near Atlanta, Georgia, correct.
How do you like Atlanta compared to here in Florida?
I just like the change of seasons. It's a great place to live. I love it down here, too, but after a while, back in the day, I just got kind of tired of it got so hot, it's cool to vacay for me. It's like, obviously, it's a great place to vacation, go play golf and hang out, but when you got to work in this kind of stuff, it's not always fun.
That's true. I think that was a big thing for me leaving New York is I loved the change of seasons, but I just didn't want to deal with the cold and the snow and all that anymore. Plus, the music scene in New York kind of fizzled out a little bit, and things really changed on the club circuit.
Sure.
And I had a next-door neighbor that lived next to me in the Bronx, who is from the Tampa Bay, Clearwater area.
Mm-hmm.
And he kind of pushed me in this direction because I was looking at the east coast of Florida, Fort Lauderdale, that type of thing, because I really didn't know any of the areas. And he was like, man, you got to go check out Tampa, because he grew up here and played with a lot of the musicians down here from the early days, like, you know, the guys in Savatage and Nasty Savage and Power Surge and all those.
It's great breeding ground for a lot of great metal bands down here.
And obviously. So he was like, dude, you need to go to Tampa. Mm-hmm. He goes, you'll find musicians, you'll fit right in. And came down here, found an apartment, and didn't know anybody when I moved down here. Didn't have any family, friends. And just basically found where the music and the motorcycles were. And
here you are.
Been here almost 9 years.
Good. Good deal.
So now, when you first came into Megadeth, you came in with your brother Glenn Drover.
Yep.
You actually came in the middle of a tour. Right,
I came in the start of the tour when the record was just completed and it was just released, literally just released. And Dave was getting ready to do a tour, but Glenn had already been in the band for about a month.
Okay.
And I kind of got the call at the last minute, literally 6 days before the tour had started, I got the call to come in as well. And yeah, it was that was definitely an experience, you know. I had to really focus on learning the songs that I didn't know.
Now you didn't have a lot of time to prepare?
No. Less than 6 days. 4 days rehearsal, travel day, show was in Reno, Nevada, just on the 6 days.
That's amazing. Now, were you already very familiar with the
material? I knew all the old stuff. I mean, that's what I didn't want to focus on, because I knew all the worst makeup. I could do it 90% just off the top of my head.
Right.
So I wanted to focus on the things that I didn't know, the things from like Cryptic Writings, and I kind of lost touch with it as they were going in a less heavy direction at the time. I was going,
right.
For me, I was going in a heavier direction, so
okay.
I kind of lost touch with it, so I had to
I think it's like that for a lot of people. Like mm-hmm. when you're very familiar with the band in their early days, and they start to like change styles, mm-hmm. because you know Megadeth for a while did go a little more, you know, radio friendly,
mm-hmm.
especially like with the Risk record and stuff.
Yeah,
I didn't know any of
that era at all. So, you know, just getting acclimated with things that I didn't know and focusing on that, and then obviously we pulled it off. So you know, here we are almost 10 years later. So
well, so now you are. Basically the longest running drummer that Megadeth has had up to this point, correct? Or at least close to it.
I think I know Nick was in the band obviously a long time. Nick Menza was in the band probably close to 10 years as well, so I really don't know. I mean, I don't really look at the statistics part of who's been here the longest. It doesn't really matter to me, but yeah, I guess obviously I'm certainly one of the longest running members in Megadeth's history, certainly.
Right. Now, the first album that you actually played on was United Abominations.
Mm-hmm.
What's your favorite song on that record?
Sleepwalker.
Okay, that would probably be mine too.
Yeah.
Now, out of all the records you've played on since then, what would you say is your favorite record?
Endgame,
okay, yeah. Cool.
I like them all for different reasons, but if you're asking me to pick a favorite.
Now, what would be the reason for Endgame being your favorite?
It's a heavier record. I'm always an advocate for the heavier stuff. I mean, luckily for me, I've got one of my songs on there, a song called Head Crusher, which is really well received. A lot of fans really dig that tune.
Yeah, great song.
A lot of heavy stuff in that record. I really like it. I like them all, obviously like them all. I like United Abominations as well. It's got a lot of really great songs on it. You know, it's like asking what your favorite child is. So I love them all.
It's very difficult.
I love them all, but some of them are cuter than others.
I hear that. Now, since you became in the band, you've actually had the ability to go on a lot of different tours,
mm-hmm.
and you've played with a lot of great bands since then. And we were talking a little bit earlier, and like you said, you had the guitar player from one of my favorite bands, Diamondhead, come jam with you.
Brian Tyler. Yeah.
Right. And he came up and jammed with you on Am I Evil.
He jammed with the Big Four, actually, a couple of times for Am I Evil. I believe that was in 2011. But also as well, we had Diamond Head tour with us back in 2005. We did a full European tour with those guys. Can't say enough great things about them. Obviously, they're a very influential band in the early 80s on many bands, you know, obviously Metallica and Megadeth and countless others as well. Brian's a great guy, wonderful person, and all the band, they're all a bunch of great guys. So yeah, I've had many great experiences with Brian and Diamond Head.
Awesome. How was playing on the Big Four tour in general, like with all?
It was amazing. We did all the shows we did. Every one of them was amazing. You know, we played. Yeah, we were the first heavy metal inhabitants of Yankee Stadium. That in itself is a milestone. Playing that venue.
And I know that was a big deal for the guys in Anthrax.
Of course it was. What better homecoming for those guys? You know, than to play on their home turf. I mean,
right.
I talked to those guys and they're all good friends of mine and stuff. And I know that was a special day for them, so it was very cool.
Yeah, I know that would have been huge for me too, because I was born and raised in the Bronx.
Right.
And so for anybody born and raised in the Bronx, so just in New York City in general,
yeah.
You know, being able to headline Yankee Stadium, you know,
yeah.
was just an amazing
thing. Yeah,
it was a great day. Even for any band.
It was a great day, absolutely.
So, prior to being a Megadeth, you came out of a Canadian metal band called Eidolon, which
mm-hmm.
some people might be familiar with, some people might not.
Right.
Tell us a little bit about Eidolon and how that whole thing started.
Well, Glenn and I started that in the mid-90s. It was purely just an instrumental, originally an instrumental shred project, you know, just instrumental music with a bunch of wacky solos on and stuff. Because we're big fans of, you know, Tony McAlpine and all that kind of stuff from the 80s and stuff, which is great. That, I guess, migrated into why don't we write some songs and get a singer. And so we released several records. We got signed to Metal Blade, released several records on that. And it never harbored any success, which is unfortunate. But when you don't, when the record company doesn't give you the opportunity to tour, your record's pretty much dead in the water. So which that kind of sucked. But ultimately, that band served a greater purpose because we played two festivals in Germany. We played the Wacken Festival in 2003, and we played with Megadeth in 2001 at a festival called Bang Your Head Festival,
okay.
which is an odd coincidence. But a fan, when Dave put back together Megadeth, he reached out to our webmaster, a guy named Dave McRobb, Canadian guy, and kind of put feelers out, said, you know, hey, why don't you kind of scope out and see if the kind of players are out there, anybody that, you know, think you should recommend. And Dave McRobb recommended Glenn solely on the fact that a fan saw us at that festival, Wacken Festival in Germany, and sent a couple of CDs to Dave McRobb. Don't even know why, it's just odd how things happen in life, but that's kind of the short story of all this, how this all kind of took place. I mean, Eidolon never had any success.
So that's how you. But that's how you.
Had that, you know, had we not played Wacken in Germany and met this guy from England who was a fan, his name was Sam Shuttleford. And it's just weird how that whole thing kind of took place. It was just a very, you know, and then out of the blue, all of a sudden Glenn gets an email asking if he wants to audition for Megadeth. So neither of us ever auditioned for Megadeth. It just came out of the blue. And had it not been for those records, though, we would not have got the call. So
yeah, of course.
Eidolon served the greater purpose in ultimately getting us both into Megadeth. So
now the last Eidolon record was in 2006.
It came out in 2006. We recorded it. We recorded it as Glenn just got the Megadeth guy. I was in Sweden cutting tracks for that record at Andy LaRocque, King Diamond's guitar player studio, while Glenn had the gig. He just got the Megadeth gig. So it was a very exciting time. But because we joined Megadeth, everything was...
Now Glenn also played on the King Diamond record. Glenn played, right?
Yeah, Glenn was in King Diamond for 3.5 years prior to all the Megadeth stuff as well. So.
Okay.
Yeah, he's been around the block a couple times, certainly.
Yeah. So now Glenn gets the call, he gets the audition from Megadeth, mm-hmm. obviously he gets the gig.
Mm-hmm.
Then I guess Nick Menza is not up to par as far as being able to...
I'm not aware of the exact circumstances. For whatever reason, it didn't work out.
Right.
And they said, well, I get the call to, you know, what do you think about doing it? I knew I could do it musical-wise. It was just a matter of, it was such, you know, literally came home on a Friday from work and my life got turned upside down in 12 hours. So it was
I can imagine.
It was a split decision. It had to be made at that moment. So obviously I took it, you know, can't turn something like that down playing one of my favorite bands on the planet. So it's just weird how things work out in life. And but I'm glad that things turned out the way they did.
Yeah, I think everybody is. I know one of my favorite live DVDs is Blood on the Water.
Yeah?
Yeah.
That's a cool one. Yeah, we did that in San Diego. That was a lot of fun. All the live DVDs we do are fun. It's a picture of a musical moment in time and stuff. So it's cool that we kind of document that a lot. We've obviously done a lot of live DVDs in recent years, and it's cool to do that. We do them different. You know, we did a great one in Argentina that one night back in 2005. So we've done several. They're all fun.
Very cool. Now you were saying that Eidolon originally started kind of like a shred project.
Yep.
Do you find yourself playing differently in Megadeth than you did on the Eidolon stuff, style-wise?
Yeah, I guess to a point. I mean, my style didn't drastically change. I mean, I play how I play. But it's more of a collaborative effort with, you know, when we're in the studio doing Megadeth stuff, the ideas bounce off the engineer, Dave, and myself. You know, and we kind of come up with a game plan and formulate how we want the song structured with drums and stuff, whereas with the Eidolon stuff, it was me. If Glenn would have an idea, he would tell me, and I would either say, yeah, it's a great idea, or no, I don't like it, or I'll try it, but, you know. Right. Ultimately, the Eidolon stuff, I wrote most of the music for.
Okay.
So I knew, when I wrote the guitar riffs for the songs, I knew how I wanted the drums to go. And Glenn was responsible for, you know, he was the producer and the engineer, because Glenn had the studio. We kind of had an understanding, like, I'll write most of the stuff, because you're so busy doing what you have to do. I'll handle the music end of it. So.
Now, a lot of people might not be familiar with the fact that you're also a guitarist.
Yeah.
And you've actually sat in and played on stage with Megadeth from time to time, correct?
Yep. Yeah, we've done that. We call it when Glenn was in the band, we called it the switcheroo, where we would play half a piece cells. When Dave was doing a solo, little solo break in the middle, Glenn would go behind the amps, and I would jump off and grab his guitar, and we would switch for into the song. It was fun, something to do. We could pull it off, and it was a lot of fun. So it gave the fans something a little different to see.
Yeah, I would have liked to have actually seen that myself. I've seen Megadeth on pretty much every tour, but never got to actually see you come out from behind the drums.
Cool.
So that's pretty cool. A lot of people may not also know that you're responsible for bringing Chris Broderick and Dave Ellison back into Megadeth as well, correct?
That was a huge part of it. Yeah, when Glenn decided to leave the band, we had to come up with a strategy of replacements, because you just can't, Glenn wasn't about to just say, I quit and I don't care what happens. He cared a lot. But so we had a short list of people who we knew could cut the gig. It's an extremely difficult gig to emulate all those Marty Friedman souls and Chris Poland souls and Al Petrelli and Jeff Young souls. They're extremely difficult. So the list was very short. And Chris was on the top of our list. We didn't know. We knew Chris was from Denver, but we didn't even know he relocated to Los Angeles, which is very convenient. And he was without a band at the time. So within a day of Glenn quitting, management was on the phone with Chris and talking to Dave, and it very quick turnaround. Wow. Ellison was a situation where we were going to replace the bass player, and it was the coming up on the Rust in Peace anniversary tour. My mindset was, we can't throw any Joe Schmo bass player in there, because so many people loved James Lomenzo, yeah, who had been in the band for a while, as did I. He was a great, great bass player, great person. So for me, as a fan, from a fan's perspective, there was only one choice. That was David Ellison. The trick was to get David to agree to it, and then get Dave to agree to that idea.
Right.
So obviously it worked out. And but yeah, I played a big part in both of those scenarios.
Because I know Dave Mustaine actually had interest in bringing Dave Ellison back into the band earlier when he first started recording The System Has Failed.
Yeah, and I heard that. I don't know the circumstances and how that obviously didn't go down, but right, that I know there was talk of that, obviously. But for whatever reason, it didn't work out at the time. But again, things happen for a reason, and he's here today, and I'm glad he is.
Oh, yeah. A phenomenal bass player and definitely belongs in Megadeth.
Yeah.
Now, how did you know of Chris Broderick in the first place?
Well, Chris, we played a festival, Eidolon played a festival in Cleveland for Brave Words magazine, and Jag Panzer played and Nevermore played, and Chris played, did double duty.
Right?
So we watched him, and obviously we knew he was a really good guitar player, and
he's like ridiculously good.
Yeah. Come to find out that he's actually a really good guy as well, real nice guy, very humble, and his focus really is just on playing guitar, which is great. When you have people in a band, change up band members, you really don't know what you're going to get from a
right
personality standpoint. Someone could be the best player on the planet, but if he doesn't fit into the game plan, it could be problematic.
Right.
So luckily for us, Chris has turned out to be a great guy and a great player. So, and actually quite funny. So, it's we have a good time. The four of us have a great time being in the band. We're actually all good friends. So, I know that may not sound metal to you people, but hey.
No, I think it's metal. I think that the best bands almost always are more like kind of like a gang. They almost have like a,
yeah, if you share the same vision, the same musical vision, the chances of success are far greater.
It becomes like a brotherhood.
Sure. You're all in for the same cause.
Now, on this last tour, following up this latest album, Super Collider,
mm-hmm,
obviously you did a leg of the Gigantor, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Then went out with Black Sabbath.
Yep.
And now you guys are headlining and touring over here. And what's coming up for the rest of the tour after St. Petersburg tonight?
Well, we have 12 days left in this tour. We do Orlando tomorrow, then head out to Texas, finish up in Reno, Nevada, which is the first show I ever did with Megadeth. So it's a cool place for me. It's a special venue for me. So then we take Christmas break, and then I know we've announced some shows in Australia for mid to end February. So We're doing those. After that, I honestly don't know what the game plan is. I know things are in the works, but until we get 100% confirmation or anything, I really don't pay much attention to it. So, but there's definitely going to be more touring next year as well, so stay tuned for that.
A new album?
We're not going to be doing a new album until we finish the world tour, whenever that is. Then we write the record. It's a process. It doesn't happen overnight. So, but, you know, I wouldn't think we would have anything until 2015. Don't quote me on that, but that's kind of what I'm ballparking right now. I wouldn't think that we would have a record released to the public before 2015, because we still have a lot of touring to do for Super Collider.
Okay. How was touring with Black Sabbath?
It was great. We toured Black Sabbath. We toured with Iron Maiden. Did several shows here in America with Maiden. Both scenarios were amazing. The Black Sabbath thing, we did South America, all soccer stadiums and stuff. So that was such a great.
That had to be amazing.
Of course, yeah. I mean, playing with Sabbath, with Ozzy, that's obviously a bucket list thing for me. So, and they're all such great people and a pleasure to tour with. So. You can't say enough great things about that experience.
Got any good stories from the tour?
No, I mean, no, not really. It's the whole experience was just really positive. I mean, you know, we show up, did the gig, and left. You know, there wasn't, you know, there's not a lot of hanging around, because in South America you're not on a tour bus,
right.
So you can't hang out. You've got to get back to the hotel because you got to fly the next morning to the next destination. So there's really not a lot of time that. Hang out and chit chat and all that other kind of stuff. So it was kind of like get to the gig, you know, do the gig, and make your way back to the hotel so you can get a good night's sleep for the airport the next day.
I get that.
And so, but yeah, the overall experience obviously was amazing.
What's what's like your favorite road story from being in Megadeth?
Jesus, I can't even. I mean, dude,
there's got to be so many.
I'll tell you a funny story. I've got tons of those. We did. I'll tell you a funny Mike Portnoy story. We did Gigantor 2005. It was the last show, and often bands will kind of mess with each other. And Portnoy decided to baby powder my snare drum. Actually, he jumped on stage and played Peace Cells, and I jumped on guitar. So that was probably the first time in history of the band where all four band members of Megadeth were playing guitar and bass. And Portnoy played drums, so after he was done with the song, he completely blasted my coated snare drum with baby powder. So I jumped on the kit to play Holy Wars, and it's on video. It's actually on the Gigantor DVD, in slow motion, by the way. And I just hit that snare, and it just went whoosh. So it was quite humorous, and I haven't paid him back for it, but I will, believe me.
You will, you'll get him.
Yeah.
Pretty cool.
Tons of great stories, that's just one of them.
Got another one?
No.
No?
Nothing that I can repeat.
Okay. So thanks for talking.
Yeah, appreciate it, man.
I appreciate your time.
Thank you.
And hopefully, you know, I'll get to talk to you some more.
Absolutely.
And I'm looking forward to the show tonight over at Janice Landing.
Yep, Janice Landing's going to be great.
And that's it.
Right on, bud. Appreciate it, man. Thank you. Hellraiser, Ball Rocks.
Yeah, we are back on the Hellraiser. And that was the Shawn Drover interview from this past weekend over at Seminole Music and Sound. And I'm back here with Dr. Dan.
Yeah.
And Dr. Dan, before that interview, we were talking a little bit about yourself.
Yes.
And about the upcoming Storyteller Store.
Yes.
So let's go more into your musical influences and your career a little bit.
Well, my career, which is almost null, I mean, I started out as a physician. And after doing that for like 20 years, I decided to get back into music, which was my first love. Ran across John Oliva, and that was like 15 years ago. And ever since then, we've been kind of like writing together and loving each other for what we do and feeling blessed for what we do. And we've got to the point where we finally did the Oliva Raise the Curtain album, and have several other albums in the works. And the newest thing right now is this Saturday night coming up, which we're going to do the last Storyteller show for the season. There may be several more in the future. I don't know for sure. But we plan on having a great show with special guests. Appearing on Saturday night. people that helped us on the last CD, and we're looking very much forward to it, plan to have a sold out house. I think it will go great. We'll enjoy it, have a great time.
Yeah, and I for one am looking forward to it.
Cool.
And so I can't wait for Saturday to come. And I heard the last time when we were here talking to John, he had said that they're actually going to document this show, right? And
yes.
They're planning on videotaping it.
Yes.
And so
yes.
You know, hopefully I'll be actually able to share on that and be one of the people up there,
yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Helping with it. And I can't wait.
Yeah.
I know we touched on it the last time that, you know, and you and I were talking warfare about the next John Oliva record, the next JOPM.
Yes.
And, you know, he had said that this is going to be one of the heaviest records he's ever done, or the heaviest album he's ever done.
Yeah,
we talked a little bit about some of the expectations that go along with that.
Yeah, well, they're, you know, phenomenal expectations, but, you know, we definitely want to be able to do it, and we don't want to let down any of the fans. And John and I have both expressed to each other that I guess at this point in our careers that we're too long, too old to fuck around, if I'm allowed to say that. We want to give something to the people that's very memorable, very different, very heavy, and hope they'll all love it and remember it while we're pushing up Daisy someday.
And I think they will. I don't think there's any way that people aren't going to remember it, especially if this last collaboration effort between the two of you is any indication of what's to come. I think it's going to be fantastic.
Thank you. I think it will be too. It's going to be a lot of, you know, it's going to be a lot of hard work. You know, there's going to be a lot of effort put into it. You know, but I really believe we'll be able to pull it off.
Awesome. Now, outside of collaborating with John, you also have some other projects that you're doing, right?
Yeah. You know, I do a lot of different things. You know, I'm not like stuck on any. Particular genre of music, you know. I write my Christmas stuff. I sometimes get to help John a little bit, you know, on running some of TSO stuff. I do other bizarre things, you know, besides writing rock and ballads. I'm into even, which I never thought I would be into, but I do some hip hop stuff and. Have some gentlemen that I met out of the college that were great with their drum beats and things like that, and so I do that, and all that will be presented also in the future. And but right for, you know, for right now, the main agenda is getting out the best heavy metal album of all time from John Oliva. That will be under JOP. We also have in the works the next solo album and several of those in the works. We have a library right now of approximately 127 songs.
Oh, wow.
That, you know, we wrote, let's say, within the past 12 months. We really went on a writing spree after Matt's Laporte's demise. That was basically our inspiration to show Matt that we wanted to, you know, write a lot of songs on his behalf and in his memory, and as good as he was capable of writing them, which, you know, he was a genius also, just like John. So that's what we're doing. You know, we're just going to give it our best effort, you know, and see what happens. And we don't plan on letting anybody down.
Awesome. I know I can't wait to hear it. So are you going to be actually on stage with John at the Storyteller Story? You can't tell us yet.
I can tell you. I'm going to be there for several songs, okay? Each of us are taking our fair share of the show. I'm going to be doing several songs with him, such as Soldier, 10 Years, Father Time, which Father Time was the second riff his brother Chris Oliva had ever written in his life when he was approximately 13, 14 years old. So I know those three songs I'll definitely be doing with them. Also, in conjunction with all of that, is Tom Morris and Jim Morris from Morris Sound Studios. They'll be filling in on certain songs, and also Dr. Lorian, who's an internal medicine specialist that did do several riffs on several of the songs. He'll be there, and we're just going to have a great time, entertain everybody, and hope everybody has a lot of fun.
And I'm sure everyone is going to have a lot of fun. And on that note, why don't we give people a little more insight as to what's going on by playing the last interview that we did right here.
Sounds
at,
good.
At Adventureland Studios.
Absolutely.
And then we'll come back, we'll talk a little bit more, we'll wrap the show.
Okay. Sounds
very
good.
Cool. Here's the Jon Oliva interview from just a few weeks ago.
Yeah.
Taped right here at Dr. Dan's Adventureland Studio.
Yeah.
And we'll be back on Hellraiser's Bowl in just a little bit.
Rock on.
Where do you want to stand?
I'm going to stand right by you, right here.
Are you going to be in film?
Can I smoke?
All right. Are we ready?
We're all right.
No, very cool.
Dummy up.
It's all What's recording.
That? No, very cool.
Let's go.
You guys are recording.
Shut up. Let's go.
Hellraiser's Ball rocking it out right here tonight at Dr. Dan's recording compound, also known as
Adventureland. Yes.
And I'm here with the mastermind, the Savatage, and Dr. Butcher's, and of course, John Oliva's Pain.
And a whole bunch of other bands you've never fucking heard of.
And a bunch of stuff nobody ever fucking heard of. And we're going to be talking about the Raise the Curtain album.
Yes.
And of course, the upcoming Storytellers Tour.
Yes. Correct? Yes. Yes, we have to talk about that. And I have my counterpoints and crime with me.
And we have Dr. Dan behind us, and of course, Chris Kender.
Yes.
And we'll be talking to these guys too.
Well, we're not going to really ask them.
No, we're not going to.
Yeah, we're just here to... for good looks.
Okay. Anyway. So let's talk about the upcoming tour.
Well, upcoming tour, we're leaving the day after Thanksgiving, and we're going up northeast and stuff and doing this storyteller thing and ending it here in Tampa with a very special show where we're bringing out all the people that worked on the album, Doc and the guys from Morris Sound and people like that that, you know, aren't going to be with us on the tour. But for the show in St. Pete, we're bringing everyone out. We're going to have a great time and do a bunch of stuff that no one's ever heard of, which is great.
Awesome.
And it's going to be fun, so you got to come out and...
yeah, I would definitely like to be a part of it.
Well, you're going to be there.
Yeah, of course.
We're even going to give you a ticket.
Oh, thank you very much.
Well, Chris... All right, maybe we're not going to give you a ticket. We're going to give Piper a ticket, and he can give it to you.
That'll work.
Does that work?
That'll work. And so now that's on December 14th.
December 14th at the State Theater, the new refurbished State Theater. And it's going to be a lot of fun. I'm really... To be honest with you, I'm really looking forward to that night more than any of the others because we're gonna pull these guys out, the Morris brothers and Doc here and
Diaz
and all these people that are involved with what Chris and I and Doc are doing with this thing. It's gonna be special. It's gonna be a lot of fun, and y'all gotta come out there and laugh with us because on top of that, I'm gonna be telling some great stories. Embarrassing, most of the people I'm embarrassing are dead. Right. No offense, you know. But
so you
some really funny
story.
Now, well, it's true stuff.
Right.
And it's going to be great, and you got to come out and see it, because it's a once-in-a-lifetime show.
So now this is kind of like a behind-the-curtain.
Right, behind-the-curtain, right. Exactly, because it's, you know, it's behind the scenes, and it's basically like, you know, I go through the whole history of Chris and me with Savatage and even before Savatage and
going through that whole thing, through the TSO stuff and the JOP stuff, and then this new record, and you know, and touch base and with people that I've been involved with that are no longer with us, you know, like Chris Oliva and Greg Marchak and Matt Laporte and people like that that have been a big part of what we've done but are no longer with us. And you know, it's going to be special. So it's something that, it's a once in a lifetime thing, you can't miss it. You know, Chris said that he would, even if you couldn't get a ticket, Chris said he would wait out front and pay for everybody's ticket that didn't have money to buy it.
Well, that's very nice of Chris.
Isn't that nice?
Yeah,
it's very great.
Indeed.
So we can extend that invitation to all the Hellraiser ball listeners.
It was a joke. It was a joke. Actually, it was Dr. Dan who's going to stand out and pay for everybody's ticket. No, it was actually Piper
that's going to
stand out.
Let's play him.
But no, I just want everyone, it's going to be a great night, great fun. And something what we're doing one time, it's a one-time thing, and you got to come out and see it.
Now, some people kind of got a taste of this back in April, correct? Like when you did the April 6th, the pre-CD?
Yeah, I played, we did like a listening thing.
Listening
so people
party.
Heard, you know, and, you know, this album, that's why it wasn't called JOP, because it was a different, it was a really a lot of early material of Chris's that I had that I hadn't done anything with yet. And I realized once we started working with it that it was like, you know, this is not like the JOP stuff has its sound and its heaviness, kind of like Savatage. And this stuff was kind of very varied. And I was like, you know, this is better if I do it this way. Plus, I've always wanted to be a lead guitar player. I mean, Jesus Christ, man, I had Chris Oliva. Then I have Chris Caffrey, Al Petrelli, all these guys who are like, and I'm like, fuck them, man. I was like, I want to fucking play.
You want to play.
So this was my opportunity, so I got to satisfy myself doing that and pay tribute to my brother and make sure that we got all of Chris's music out for the people to enjoy. And that's why I was put under this type of thing. You know, I've been involved with Chris for 10 years plus, and it was... wasn't like, you know, when we lost Matt, it was a traumatic thing for us, you know.
Of
it was
course.
Like, you know, Chris and me have really been the solids with the JOP thing from the start. It was like, you know, at that time, I was like, Jesus Christ, here we go, and what do you want to do? And then I just thought, at the time, it was best to do this, and do this, get this out. It's a little different, and it gave me and him a chance to sit back and go, what do we want to do with JOP? So we stopped and we said, like, well, what we're going to do is we're going to fuck everybody up now, because we did this album, which is very versed and very versatile, and very, and the next album, right, but the next album, you ain't going to hear no fucking choirs or anything pretty. It's going to be like,
it's going to be old school.
I said, I got to do the heaviest record I've ever done.
No,
that's it. And this new record is going to be the heaviest record we've ever done.
Awesome.
So, you know,
I definitely
believe that I have a bridge for sale. No,
well,
but it is.
To
it
that
is.
Too.
Oh, so you're gonna love
be
it.
More in line with like the first like three Savatage albums.
No, it's gonna bury those. No,
bury
no, those are too weak.
Compared
this
to
is like there's nothing happy about this record at all, and I want it that way. There's no pretty things. There's nothing pretty about it at all. It's like I did enough pretty on this. Show everybody, okay, I, you know, I could do whatever, I like to do different things, but now it's like, you know, I have all these guys with the war paint, the, you know, yeah, you guys don't get it, it's time to go to school, so, well, it's time to go to school. I know what we should do.
Okay.
Oh, sexy baby.
Oh, much better.
Oh,
much
yeah.
Better.
That's
the...
You bet. Yeah, but you look good.
Willie Nelson, what's up, baby?
Yeah.
Oh, sexy baby.
Oh, much better.
Oh,
much
yeah.
better.
I think he had it.
You bet. Yeah, but you look good. But anyway, JC, that's very important.
Willie,
everybody show up. for this show, because it's going to be special, and I'm going to make it extra special for my, you know, hometown people. You know, we're from here, you know, so for you guys, you're getting the last show of the tour, so we're going to be well practiced.
Yeah,
by the time we get here,
primed up.
There's going to be no fuck-ups going on. Yeah. And then we're going to drag people like this guy out to like perform with us and really embarrass ourselves. So. But it's going to be great, and I want you to be there. And, you know,
at least you get embarrassed.
Right. It's going to be a lot of fun.
It's going to be great.
So now, where does the tour start?
Chris, where are we going?
We're going to leave on Friday and drive up to Charlotte as our first gig.
So you're leaving this Friday?
We're Friday after Thanksgiving next week.
Okay.
And then we're going to Raleigh, and we head up the East Coast, New York, New Jersey, Pittsburgh.
Cleveland?
We're heading over towards Cleveland. We're going to be in Akron at Tim Ripper Owens has his own club, so we're going to be going to his place.
Me and him are going to do Merry Christmas Rabbi together.
Yep. Awesome. And we're going to be playing at the famous Rex Theater in Pittsburgh. Then we move down, we move over and a little bit down, and then we head down to Dallas and Houston.
How about them Cowboys?
And then back to a 2-day ride home, and then we're back into St. Pete where, you know,
to punish everybody.
It's gonna be ugly.
We want to film. We're gonna film that. We're filming that night.
It's gonna be long and it's gonna be ugly, but it's gonna be really fun.
Make the St. Pete show a little special. We're filming that night, so I want everyone there, and it's going to be very fun. And you guys are never see a show like this. I watch a lot of these storytellers shows on VH1. They're all fags. All right, it's like they don't do it right. This is really in depth. All the stories are true. I'm going to embarrass myself along with most of the previous members of Savatage.
Yeah,
but it's going to be great, and I think that'll give everyone a full perspective of what's gone on through the whole career. I just want everyone to show up and have a good time, buy as much merchandise as possible.
Of course. And so, is there going to be a variety of different merchandise available?
We're going to have naked pictures of Dana. There's going to be stuff, but we're going to come out and talk with everybody. And the thing that's great about the show is before the show, I pass a hat around. Okay. And there, inside the hat are all these things about what stories I'm going to tell. So the people can pick, because I've got a million of them. Let me tell you, I got a million. And they get to pick, and those are the stories I'm going to tell that night. And they're all true. I'm even going to bring a Bible out on stage and swear on it that everything I'm saying.
Everything you're saying is true.
Everything I'm saying is true, and it is, and I swear to God on my son's life that it's true. Nothing I'm making up, and these guys tell these stories, and they're all like, right, I'm telling the truth. Will you shut the fuck up? I'm talking. I mean that. Chris, I could not do anything without this guy, and this guy right here, the same thing. Very talented people. And just come out, and you know, I want you all to just see just how good these guys are. So much the little guy, but this guy here is good.
So now, during the storyteller show, you're also going to be playing songs with the band in between.
Well, yeah. I mean, we're doing it's. Chris, how would you explain it? It's kind of like we're doing a lot of stuff live, right. But I'm going to be doing a lot of alternate versions of songs, like. The way songs were originally written, and everyone has Savatage demos. Oh, I've got the demo from my.
Right.
Yeah, but you don't have the original writing CDs or cassettes that I have. Out on the Streets, for instance, a song that was on two Savatage albums that people have heard with it's all guitar and stuff.
Right.
Well, the song was originally written on piano and played on piano, so that's how I'm going to perform it. So a lot of these songs. I'm going to perform the way they were written, not as much the way that people
heard them.
Right. So that's the thing that makes it even more special, is you're never going to hear these versions again.
Well, I'm sure you're going to record them on your fucking camera phone. But
no problem.
You know what I'm saying? But these are different versions of everything. And the stories that go along with them lead it all up. And it just shows where everything went, you know, from how it started, and, you know, from Chris's first contributions, the way we worked together, to through Savatage, through the losing Chris and having to readapt, and then going to TSO, to JOP, and going through everything up until the present, which is this last album, which also is like a full circle, because this last album contains the first music Chris and I ever wrote together.
And the last of it.
Yeah. Yeah, and the last of it. There is nothing. The first and the last, there's nothing left.
Wow.
So that to me alone makes it something like, you know, it's very special. The stories that I'm going to tell people before certain songs are going to make you think. It's going to be like, wow, that's where I never, you know, because they're all true. And there's some good ones too, yeah. Bro. I'll tell you.
I can't wait to hear them.
Oh, no, you can't. I'm telling you, there's some good ones. I know Wackles will be like, I can't believe you told people about this.
Is he invited to the show?
Not this one, no.
No,
because this is where I'm going to hook them up. You know?
Okay.
Well, no, but it's all in good fun. And there were some funny, you know, Savatage was a very funny band in its history. There was a lot of funny shit that went on.
Tom!
What the fuck? A lot of funny shit, but it's all true.
Right.
And shit that people seen this Anvil show on VH1, uh-huh. Anvil Bill. Spinal Tap, dude, I'll make that shit look like fucking Mary Poppins fucking.
So what are the chances of a Savatage documentary?
I don't know, I'm working on a book, so these are excerpts from this book that I'm putting together, kind of like going through the whole thing. So these are certain stories that I have treasured that are great that I've pulled out,
right.
You know, like, you know, Wackles with the hairy Holland woman and duct tape on the plane wings, and, you know, the dwarf with cocaine up his nose and the bowels of the mountain can fit it. All shit that people are going to be like, holy shit, and it's all true. I wouldn't make it up, because you can't right. make shit like
no,
this
can't.
Up. I, you know, I'm not that good. Anyway,
and
peace.
People get to hear it. So now what about the, talk about the record.
Well, the record is, I'm very proud of. You know, my two friends here, dearest friends, have their help on this record was just, without them, this record would not have happened. This guy here, who, after we lost Matt, you know, I spent a lot of time down here with him because I was getting over what was going on with Matt, and it was very early because I was working in the afternoons with TSO, so I would come here and hit this poor bastard. I'd go, call him at 8:30, go, are you up? Well, I am now. I'm coming over. So I just started coming over, and I just kind of like, and then with Chris, Chris had a lot of stuff going on, so Chris was more like in the later part of the day. So it was kind of like I would come here and fiddle around with him for a few hours, and I'd go to TSO and get tortured for, you know, a couple, two, 3 hours. And I would either come back here or I'd call him and go like, I can't take it anymore.
Right, right, right.
But these guys, when it come down to crunch time, this record, without them, forget it, would never have happened. You know, Doc, as far as his songwriting goes and his bizarre organ playing, because he's like me, he doesn't know, have any clue what he's doing. Kinder's the only one of the three of us that has any kind of result of what's going on. He knows, like, well, this is 4 and 12, and we're like, 4, 12, 16, what's the difference?
Yeah, right.
Well, he's like, there's a big fucking difference. But we didn't know that, so he's like me. He reminds me of my brother, except he plays organ or keyboards instead of guitar. My brother used to do the same thing this guy would do to me. I'd go like, don't mess with anything. And I'd come here the next day and go, he'd go like, hey man, I messed with that thing last night.
Right.
They told me not to touch it.
Right.
But he made it better.
Right.
Chris would come in, I'd go like, well, I got this. And he'd go like, well, let me mess with it. And he would play, go take it home and come back and play a beat for me. And it would be like,
all right, well, yeah, whatever. You just play this one, and I'll just kind of move over.
Right.
Because they're very talented like that. So I'm very lucky to have.
Yeah, it's great to have people you can collaborate with.
These two I trust. I trust fully. You know, no one, especially that guy. No one else I trust. But these guys, I put my life on the line with them anytime. And they're very talented. And they're wonderful dancers and a lot of fun at parties.
And that makes it even more entertaining.
Yeah.
And so we're going to hear some of the songs off the new record.
Yeah.
When you,
we should listen to Father Time, which is the first Chris Oliva riff that was used as a song. It was the second riff that he wrote. The first riff he wrote was Smoke on the Water Backwards. And he comes to me and goes, I got this great riff. Bam, 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 bam. I'm like, dude, it's fucking Smoke on the Water. All right, and he goes home all pissed off. He comes back the next day and he goes, I got this new riff. And I'm like, yeah, I'm thinking of, now it's going to be what, Space Trucking
right.
or Highway Star. And he goes, da-da-da-chick-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da actually the first song that Chris wrote a part, and we took it together and wrote a song together. That's why that song is so important. We should listen to it right now. What do you think?
I think it's a great time to listen to it.
I love this man.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
I need to wire.
and went back on Hellraiser's Ball, and that was Father Time by John Oliva. So
and
now,
these guys.
Being that's one of the first riffs that was ever, well, the first riff that...
That's the first Chris Oliva song.
Why hasn't it ever popped up on a Savatage album before?
Well, because I didn't find it until...
So it kind of got lost in the shuffle.
I had a shoebox full of tapes, cassette tapes, that when Chris passed away, that I had gotten. And if you've noticed, through the whole JOP era, every album, Chris Oliva was a part of every JOP album. Because I would go through these tapes and I would find these little things and I would be like, oh, great, you know. And then after Festival album, I was like, God, I've only got like three or four of these cassettes left. And I went and I put them on. The first cassette had like, you know, On Easter Rocket! You know, nothing. It was like, what is that? Or it had like the Cars on it. Or, and then I found these two, and it was this stuff from very early. Where
so this is before, like, before Savatage.
This is before you, Avatar.
Right, before Avatar. Like, you had another band called Alien, correct?
Right, Alien Metropolis. We were a bunch of stuff.
Right.
These songs were the first group, the stuff on this is the first group of music that Chris and I wrote together. That we were like, let's write a song together. So Father Time was one. The song 10 Years. He had this chorus, you know, I live these lonely days, 10 years has slipped away. And Danny had this piece of music that was great, and I loved it. And I was like, I had this little bit of Chris music, and I was like, God, I need something to put this in. And I come to his house one day, and he goes, I got this great song. And all of a sudden, I just said, like, oh, my God. And I went, boom, boom, I live, right off of his song.
Yeah.
And it went like this, it went.
Well, it just all came together.
It just came
totally,
together.
Totally
came
out.
Together.
Totally freaked me out.
Yeah, we were both looking at each other going, like,
yeah.
Wow.
It was a magical moment.
Very magical. And that's the thing. Now, the song we're going to listen to is my favorite on the album. It's called Can't Get Away. And this is a song when Chris first got his 12-string double neck. And we couldn't, it took us 4.5 hours to tune it. We actually had to call the music store, like, how do you tune this fucking thing? But we got
it's
it in
not,
tune.
It's not easy if you never tune.
And I'll show you. I'm going to demonstrate for you right now. Chris came up with this part, and it was. And that was it, and it was all on this 12-stringer he was going. But I never did anything with it. So then when it came to this album, I had some stuff that I was like. And I was able to work Chris's stuff into it. And that's why this song means a lot to me, because the ending, where it gets very big and we have real horn section come in, it's like. Gotta get stronger inside. Gotta start changing. That was all something Chris had that we had never used before.
Yeah.
So it was very cool because I was able to take these two little fragments that he had, that this one thing that was like 12 seconds long. That was all there was on the cassette. Then it went, and then you heard Waffles going like, I can't hear my cymbals. Yeah, I'm like, you interrupted that for I can't hear my fucking cymbals. But that's the truth. And then the other thing I had was just Chris sitting there with an acoustic going, da, 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 da. And he was just playing an acoustic going, I was like, oh my God. I was like, that's great. What if I did it? And we took it and we added the brass and the heavy, Chris added the heavy drum beat and we added the horns and Doc and I, we added the horn section. It was like all of a sudden it went from Chris Oliva going, to what you hear on the album, which you're going to hear in a minute at the end, where it's all, but I got it stronger. And we took it and made it, boom,
bigger.
big, and you're going to hear it here in a second.
Awesome. Right? See how I demonstrated that? I don't even get paid extra for that shit at all.
So give us a quick intro to it, and let's cut to the song.
It's called I Can't Get Away. It's my favorite song on the album, as well as these guys too. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Here we go. Stop on a dime.
I'll give up. I'm a fool for your love. I can't hide from the truth, so I guess I'll give up.
Back with Hellraiser's Ball, and that was Can't Get Away.
Can't Get Away.
So tell us, like you were telling me a little bit more about the
well,
song.
Well, Can't Get Away, Can't Get Away is the ultimate song. If you want to hear every aspect of my musical career, whether it be with before Savatage, Savatage, TSO, JOP, to here, this song offers it all.
It encompasses a little bit of everything.
It encompasses everything. It has the second riff that Chris Oliva ever wrote, which is that chorus part. I don't care for you, which I demonstrated before. And that's very cool to me. And then the contributions from my cohorts here were very important. His drums on this on that song, especially in the ending stuff, was great. This guy, I talk too much about him. He's short.
I just fill in a little bit.
Yeah, he's just, we didn't use any of that shit.
Didn't use any of it?
No, we didn't use
that. Yeah, whatever.
We had other people.
We'll keep it between us.
Just between
you. Yeah. I don't hear anything.
But we use real horn players from USF. The guys from Morrisound, I was like, we want real horns. And actually, Danny did write this horn part. But it sounded so cheesy on the keyboards, I was like, I can't be cheesy.
Right.
So we got real horn players to come in, and it was funny because we had two little short Chinese women and this big, huge, gigantic guy that makes me look small.
Oh, wow.
And this other guy, and the guy, the big, gigantic guy, I'm like, this guy's going to be playing like, bro. He's playing, he pulls out a piccolo trumpet this big. And the Chinese girls who were like they were playing these big tenor saxes that were like bigger than they were.
Yeah.
And I'm sitting there going like
yeah.
So I offered them all to come out and party with me, but they all chickened out.
Yeah, they
all chickened out.
They left. They were like, nope, sorry, we got class tomorrow.
Sorry,
like, well, why don't you call me when you have no class?
Yeah. Right. They won't get away with that next time.
Next time we're not letting them.
Right.
Yeah.
But this song is my favorite song on the album, so I hope you enjoyed it. This guy right here, JC, listen to him. He's a good guy, even though he wears funny clothes. He's a good guy. And come to the show. We're all going to be there. He's going to be here, too.
I will definitely be there.
State Theater.
December
14th.
December 14th.
John Oliva, Storyteller Store.
VIP package tickets on sale.
Yes.
Well, tell them more about how they can get tickets in advance.
Well, Chris.
Well, yeah, you can go to Daddy O's, I think, is down in St. Pete there, the big across from the State Theater.
About Daddy Cool Records.
Daddy Cool Records. You can go there. You can go to the State Theater. You get them online. If you want to get the ultimate VIP package for the State Theater show, which includes sound check, show ticket, t-shirt. One of the cool things that we're offering on the for merchandise on this tour is that we had a local artist who did a freehand pencil sketch, a beautiful portrait of John from playing one of our live shows. We're doing a limited edition 300 copy run, signed and numbered. So that's all part of the package, or you can buy one at the show. You know,
and now they can get more information about the VIP package.
Yeah,
call him. Yeah. Call this just guy call right here.
You can go to the John Oliva's Pain Facebook page. Go to the event section. Everything's there. You can get all the details to where to buy tickets. All the ticket links are there for all the shows. Up the East Coast, everything.
Everything is on Facebook.
Everything, you can get everything on Facebook. It's all there. All the links, everything you need to do to get it.
Website?
Yep.
Can they get it through the website?
Well, you can go to johnoliva.net for the info, but really, if you want to go to Facebook, it's going to be your best.
Torture this guy.
It's going to be your best way.
And people will be more informed as to up-to-date information on what's happening.
Absolutely, all the day of show opportunities, and you know, we're constantly thinking of stuff we want to do. We're leaving next week, but we're still thinking. So,
to end, I just want to say, I want to give our condolences to a dear friend of ours, Barry,
Lamb,
who passed away. And I want to say, you know, we love him very much. I knew him since 1987. He was a great guy, a big supporter of me and Chris.
Yeah.
And he's going to be missed. He had a great heart. And I'm very sorry to hear that news. And the show in St. Pete will be dedicated to him. So,
awesome.
There you go.
And I'm sure there'll be more news about memorial things that are coming up for Barry and stuff like that.
I'm sure there will be.
And we'll keep people posted on the Hellraiser Ball side.
But I want everyone to know he was a very big supporter of Savatage in the early days.
Oh, yeah.
When we were.
You guys were way
very, back. Yeah. And he was there for a lot of stuff. Actually, he's involved in some of the stories I'm going to tell. And, you know, we're going to miss him. He was a great guy with a great heart. And I just want, you know, everyone say a prayer. And we'll see you in St. Pete.
Yep. And we'll see everybody on December 14th. And
rock on.
Two were professionals. What the fuck do I have to do to get you guys some? Come in!
I just been too lazy.
Nothing beats a loaded pistol.
This is Rick, this is internet.
Yeah, right?
Yeah, it is. Internet.
Hey, we're live.
Put that on silent.
No, no.
Bill collector.
We wouldn't normally.
I'm not paying you a fucking dime.
I'm recording.
Takes
right
care
now.
Of that.
No, love it.
You know we like you, Jason.
Yes.
Don't know why yet, but we're figuring out a way. The reason why.
It's not fucking up.
Yeah, it's recording. We're gonna have fun.
Are we recording?
I'm just gonna stay stoned.
Yeah.
Deal with you guys.
Shut up.
I hope he's going to take the sound out of this.
No, he's not. Why would we start calling you like...
Trust the videographer.
If you want to take a picture of my dick, you're going to need a bigger lens.
Pull it out. But when you do, we got to go in a room
she can blow
by
it
ourselves.
Can't print shit like this, right?
She can blow it out.
I'm doomed. All right, fine.
I don't know if we have time to edit this before we air it.
Just air it. We don't care.
Just air it.
Does it look like
we don't give a fuck.
I'm telling the truth.
Right.
And some of it is pretty fucking
Have you
funny.
Seen Mike Tyson's truth?
He's in homo.
Did you see that, though? He's on that was some badass
Don't
shit.
Don't ever tell him I said that.
No.
I did meet Mike Tyson once. He was about this tall with a neck like this big. I was like, oh, Mr. Tyson. And he was like,
hey. He's like a caged animal like that.
I met him at a newsstand.
Hey, don't talk bad about Tyson, all right?
Who invited you into this fucking interview anyway? This is a loose interview because
yeah.
look at this special ed class that
yeah.
I'm like
yeah.
I'm involved with. Will you shut the fuck up? I'm talking. You rolling?
You're rolling.
Action.
Can name the song again?
Can't get away.
Okay.
You're informed, I see.
Of course.
No, of course not. Right? Well.
Oh, yeah, go ahead. I thought you're the director.
Well, no, you're supposed to action.
He's supposed to say action.
No, he's not. He's got a hat.
He's
on.
The director. Go ahead, man. Okay. Action.
Action.
Okay, action.
And we are back on the Hellraisers Bowl.
Alrighty.
Got a little feedback going on here. Let's cut that. And that was the John Oliva interview that was recorded right here.
Yeah.
Just a few short weeks ago. And of course, John and company are on the road right now finishing up the Storyteller Store, which is going to culminate right here.
Yes.
In St. Petersburg, Florida. This coming... Saturday, December 14th.
Yeah.
And hold on a second here. Being that we're Sans Engineer, let me make sure that we got proper audio going on. Everything looks pretty good. So I'm really looking forward to that, you know, and everything that John was talking about as far as this show. How it's going to be completely different than
yes.
all the other shows that are going on right now, because this one's going to be like a one-off special event type thing. So
absolutely, this is for the Tampa Bay fans, man.
This is for the Tampa Bay fans. So anybody that's watching this live tonight, or anyone that sees the replay of this broadcast, you know, get your ass to the State Theater.
Absolutely.
This Saturday, December 14th. I think doors open at. Is 7 or 8 o'clock?
I think around 7.
I think doors open at 7. I think the show starts around 8. You can get more information by going to the John Oliva's Pain page.
Yes.
And they'll have the most up-to-date information on there, more than likely. I know that you could also go directly into the JOP website.
Correct.
And get information. But I would assume Facebook would probably have the most up-to-the-minute info.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Now there's also a VIP package available for this show,
yes.
which Chris Kinder talked about in the interview.
Yes.
Anyone who's a John Oliva fan, I would strongly recommend trying to get one of the VIP tickets, because that comes with the whole package with a meet and greet, plus they get a t-shirt. And,
yes, and that, and they get to be there, I think, for sound check and, you know, for many hours prior to any of the fans showing up. Yes.
Right. So I don't know if that is actually sold out or not yet, but check online. I'm sure it's available if you go to look for tickets.
Yes.
And I think the link is actually right on the JLP website. There's a link to buy tickets.
Yes.
On there.
Yes, it is.
And I'm sure it'll come up, VIP package or whatever. I know I'm going to be there. Dr. Dan's going to be there. I know there's a lot of special guests that are going to be there for the show. So looking forward to seeing as many friends and fans as possible.
Yeah, pretty much everybody that participated on the creation of the CD. Yeah.
And so that's really going to be an amazing show. It's something that I would never miss, even if I wasn't a part of this whole thing.
Yeah, it's the only.
Just as a fan alone, it's just going to be an amazing night.
Yeah, it's the. It's one in a million because I mean this is a very special show. I mean compared to. Even though he has a phenomenal career, okay, but this is very, very special for the Tampa Bay fans.
Yeah, it is. It's going to be a very special show. And, of course, I want to thank everybody that was involved in making these last two interviews happen. Of course, I got to thank you, Dr. Dan.
Thank you very much.
One, sitting in with me tonight and talking to me, of course, for allowing me to have the interview with Jon Oliva here. I'd also like to thank Melinda Morse, who was one of the videographers who helped produce the Jon Oliva interview with me. Of course, Jason Taylor from Dropshot, who also is now has his own production company, JT Productions, and he helped me out with the editing on the Jon Oliva interview. That interview you and I were talking about,
yes,
off the air. was done on multiple platforms.
Yeah, amazing. Just amazing.
So it's actually a hybrid piece that was done on a PC and a Macintosh, four different programs to actually make it happen.
Wow.
Final Cut Pro, iMovie, Pinnacle, and actually, believe it or not, Windows Movie Maker. It all came together in what you saw around here tonight.
Yeah.
We also kind of touched on this warfare. That interview will be available as a standalone interview after the Storytellers Tour culminates on Saturday.
You
can find that on YouTube between Sunday and Monday, definitely by Monday the latest. It'll be available as a standalone piece where people could, you know, could view it in its entirety just the way it was here without having to watch the entire show around it.
Yes.
I want to thank all the people over at Seminole Music and Sound, especially, you know, the manager over there, John Spinelli.
Yes.
Who hooked me up and got me the interview with Shawn Drover from Megadeth. I want to thank Shawn Drover for taking the time to talk to me and all the people over there at Seminole Music and Sound. And from what I understand, we may actually be able to give away a pair of tickets for the Jon Oliva Storyteller Show over in St. Petersburg, Florida. As of tonight, I don't have all the information, so we cannot give it away tonight on the show. If I know that that's possible, as of tomorrow, between tomorrow and Friday, I will post on Facebook how you can win the tickets, and we'll have some kind of a contest or some kind of a thing where, you know, the Hellraisers Bowl fans will be able to win. There's only one pair available.
Yeah.
And that's it. We're looking forward to seeing everybody on Saturday over at the State Theater. We've got a great show coming up next week, and this year is definitely going to finish off really strong. We have a lot of surprises in the works between now and New Year's.
Yes, we did.
And so look forward to seeing even more great interviews coming your way and some special guests and surprises between now and then. Dr. Dan, thank you once again.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
It was my pleasure.
My pleasure,
and
too.
We'll definitely do it again. And until next time.
Rock on.
Thank you. goodness!